Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to this edition of the RAL seminar series. For those of you that are here in the Zoom room, I'd just like to remind you again that after the seminar, please use the raise hands function to ask your question, and I'll call on you. And also for those of you who are on the webcast, welcome as well. And below the webcast video, you should see a Slido form where you can submit questions as well. And I'll also be monitoring that, and we'll ask those questions on your behalf. I think those are all the kind of housekeeping details that we need to take care of today. So now to welcome our speaker, Melissa Bukovsky. Melissa started as a postdoc at NCAR in 2009 and is now a project scientist 3. Her research focuses on climate change in North America and spans regional climate modeling, climate analysis, and climate change impacts. Some of her current areas of work include the examination of the influence of climate change on warm season precipitation in the southern US Great Plains, North American extratropical cyclones, US wildfire, and the influence of potential land use scenarios on climate change projections. Melissa also is currently involved with the WCRP Coordinated Regional Climate Downscaling Experiment, known as CORDEX. She is a member of the CORDEX Science Advisory Team and has produced simulations with multiple regional climate models for the North American CORDEX effort. And Melissa's seminar today is entitled The Influence of Future Land Use Changes on Regional Climate Change Projections. Melissa, the virtual floor is yours.
Okay, thanks, Jared, and thanks everyone for attending today. Today I'm gonna talk about the work that I've been doing that looks at the influence of future land use changes on the regional climate projections. Before continuing, I do wanna mention that this work started as a part of the DOE-funded FACETS project and is now ongoing under a project called HyperFACETS. I'd also like to acknowledge the other people who've contributed to the work I'm going to show today: Jing Gao, Linda Mearns, Brian O'Neill, and Lee Kesenick. So this work is really about adding additional human influence in future climate projections that are produced by regional climate models, or RCMs, and very specifically in the regional climate models, not global models. Because right now, the only factor that represents humans in a transient manner in most RCM simulations of the future are greenhouse gases. Land cover is present, but it's generally held at present day conditions, even when simulating long-term futures. This work is particularly important because the coupled model intercomparison project, or CMIP GCMs, that are often downscaled do incorporate potential future land use changes. Though how this is done and to what extent land use changes are included does vary considerably across the GCMs. But since the GCMs we downscale include the land use changes, it's important to figure out how future land use changes may matter and to what extent they may matter in order to inform future downscaling efforts. And I say that because the results of studies like this will influence how future regional climate modeling efforts are conducted. The protocol for downscaling CMIP 6 GCMs for the International CORDEX effort, the Coordinated Regional Climate Downscaling Experiment, for example, can't recommend how to do this yet because there aren't enough studies that include future land use changes in RCMs to even suggest best practices at the moment. So most studies to date have focused on idealized land use or land cover changes where entire land types are removed, added, and or replaced. Only a few published studies that use RCMs have examined more societally or policy or realistic land use changes in RCM projections so far. I have a few listed on the slide. There's Berkman's et al. 2019, which looked at near-term land use changes that are driven by European policy and how they interacted with climate change. Yilmaz et al. 2019, which looked at ongoing and near-term planned infrastructure projects and how their land use change might interact with climate as well. And then there's an ongoing CORDEX-endorsed flagship pilot study called LUCs in Europe that's looking at work that's actually similar to what I'm doing now, but across a much wider range of regional models and projections. So this work really just aims to narrow the gap in existing research, specifically using shared socioeconomic pathway or SSP informed future land use changes. And we aim to answer a rather simple question: how does the inclusion of anthropogenic land use changes modulate the RCM projections? That is, does land use change matter relative to those greenhouse gas forcings? We started by examining near surface temperature and precipitation, two of the most commonly examined variables in climate change studies. And that work was published earlier this year in Earth Futures. I've included the citation there at the bottom of the slide, and I'll have it at the end in case you're wanting to know more about the work. We've also been examining how future projections of land use change might affect projections of extreme event exposure, and are undertaking additional modeling experiments now to further disentangle the greenhouse gas land use change climate responses. I'll mostly be covering the first two aspects of this work today, though, as it's the most complete. So, on to background and some methodology. First, since I'm using shared socioeconomic pathway or SSP-informed land use changes, I wanted to provide a very brief overview of what they are in case you're not familiar with them. The SSPs are the global human storylines that could lead to different greenhouse gas concentration outcomes in the future. There are currently five different SSPs, and they're listed in that figure there at the right, ranging from more sustainable human pathways like SSP1, to those that might be considered a little bit more like business as usual, perhaps. And in this figure, worth noting that these different SSPs, global population generally increases from the lower left to the upper right, and emissions per person increase from the lower right to the upper left. And I've highlighted the two that we've focused on so far, SSP3, regional rivalry, and SSP5, fossil fuel development, or taking the highway. These different SSPs describe plausible future changes in things like demographics, development, economics, education, lifestyle, policy, technology, and natural resource use. Integrated assessment models are then used to produce quantitative projections that incorporate both the future emissions and the socioeconomic conditions that follow the different pathways. And they're also just a common way to represent human systems in climate change research, which is why we've used them here. The model that we've used is WRF, and we've leveraged quite a bit of what was done for the North American Cortex Initiative for this project. We've used the WRF configuration that was used for that program. It's a 25 kilometer resolution configuration that's run over the domain shown there, right? So most of North America. We've also leveraged the WRF configuration in terms of all of its parameterization options. It's a version 3.5.1 of WRF, and the most probably relevant bit of parameterization choice that you need to know about for this study is that it used the NOAA land surface model, not NOAA MP. And this simulation looks like somebody's waiting to enter the room. Jared, if you want to click on that. So this version of WRF was driven by the MPI ESM LR global model, which was run for CMIP-5. There's a historical run that spans 1950 through 2005 that we've leveraged from Cortex, and we've also used the future simulation under RCP 8.5 for the no land use change scenario here. And that simulation was run from 2006 all the way through to 2100. We've added to that two different land use change futures. The simulations for those were run from 2075 to 2100 under RCP 8.5 using land use change informed by SSP3 and SSP5. For those of you who are more familiar with this, you'll know that SSP3 doesn't necessarily always reach the RCP 8.5 emission concentration outcome by the end of the century. This particular SSP3 scenario is a high growth scenario that was developed for the BRACE project. And then for our analysis periods, we're looking at specifically 1980 through 2005 versus 2075 through 2100 here. The land use change scenarios themselves were produced by two different models. the agricultural land use model of Mayapen et al. 2014, which produces projections of crop and pasture at a half degree resolution, and the urban model of Gao and O'Neill, developed by Jing Gao and Brian O'Neill. And this was originally run at an eighth of a degree, but these scenarios are now available at a 1 kilometer resolution. So the agricultural land use model here does talk to the urban model, or it takes the urban land projections as inputs, and it assumes that if the two land uses competed for the same land, the urban land use would win. Both models also produce projections of land use change for the beginning of every decade, decade by decade into the future. And each provides the fraction of a grid box covered by the given land use type as an end product. Because we're only running a 25-year time slice here, we decided to just incorporate the land use change for the decade starting at 2090 for that whole time slice. 2088 is the approximate midpoint, so 2090 is the closest decade to that. And we've only incorporated the land use changes over CONUS, despite having the whole North American domain. And that's because the agricultural land use model at the time, there wasn't enough information to spatially disaggregate the projections from a country wide projection down to the half degree that the model is run at. That was only possible over the US. So that's why we only trimmed the land use model projections for urban to CONUS and only incorporated those. So what did the land use models project? Well, for SSP3 here, we have the fractional change in the land type from 2000 to 2090 for crop in the upper left, pasture in the lower left, and then urban in the middle. You can see that the projection of crop across the country increases. There's very little overall change in pasture, and there's little change in urban built land. And that's because under this scenario, countries are focused on domestic issues, particularly due to resurgent nationalism. So they're focusing on things like energy and food security, which is why the US is growing more crops under this scenario. But economic development is slow, which means that in industrialized countries, population growth is slow, and therefore built land growth is slow. This scenario does actually have, I think it's the highest global population growth compared to all of the other SSPs, but that's because of high population growth in non-industrialized countries. Okay, under SSP5, the global economy is growing quickly, fueled by continued fossil fuel exploitation. This translates to the increase in croplands being much smaller than in the previous scenario because we can still import what we need and what we're not growing. Pasture land change is also pretty low still. And then this scenario has a large increase in urban land projected. And that's because the economy is booming, population is growing because industrialized countries have more babies when the economy is booming. And with that increase in population comes that increase in urban land. So what we have here are really just two different sensitivity studies to some extent. One that focuses on a large change in built land here with SSP5, and another that focuses on cropland change under SSP3. Because pasture change is small, I'm not really going to go into detail about what it does to the climate for the purposes of this talk. Of course, this wasn't necessarily the most straightforward thing to implement into WRF. The 5 kilometer configuration of WRF used here use the 24 category USGS land types. They're listed there on the right. And crop and pasture can fall into more than two categories here. The crop land types are types 2 through 6, and potential pasture land types or anything that a cow might eat are types 7 through 10 to some extent. We decided after many different test scenarios to apply these land use changes using the delta method to just dry land crop and irrigated crop, so the crop land, depending on which one was already at a grid point. And then for pasture, we applied that change just to grassland, and the urban land was applied just to the urban built land category. Each field was adjusted so that the total change in WARF for one of those land types fell within 5% of that given by the ag and urban models for consistency. Okay, so unfortunately, the configuration of WARF that we used for this project does not allow WARF to actually see the fractional land use changes that we incorporated. This option didn't exist then for NOAA, the NOAA land surface model, but it does now. So it only calculates things like albedo and surface heat fluxes based on the dominant type of land in a grid box. So this plot here shows all the points where the dominant land type changed. The top row shows what the land cover was in the historical or in the no land use change simulation, and the bottom row shows what it changed to. So you can see here in SSP5, most importantly, we have a lot of green points here in the southeast and some in the upper Midwest. Those are all points that were forested in the historical simulation, but in the future, they have all switched over to cropland under SSP3. Under SSP5, we have a little bit of the same thing happening with the forested land becoming cropland, but we have many more purple points showing up where the dominant land type has changed to urban land for that scenario. So unfortunately, just considering the dominant land change does alter the intended amount of land use projected by the land use models. Urban land was underrepresented by about 42% in SSP5 as a result, and cropland in SSP3 was underrepresented by about 17%. But they still have an effect on the climate, nonetheless. Here, I have projections of 2-meter temperature on the far left from the no land use change future versus the historical simulation for the full year at the top, winter in the middle, and then summer at the bottom. And then on the right, I have the difference in the projections between the SSP3 land use change scenario and the no land use change on the left, SSP5 versus no land use change in the middle, and then difference between the two land use change scenarios on the right. So what you can see here in SSP3, that there's really about a 1/2 to 1 degree reduction in the projected warming here, especially near the Texas-Louisiana border. The crop increases generally just damping the warming. And across the entire CONUS, that's actually damping the warming by about 20% in the annual average. It's affecting more than just the, the statistically significant difference points that you can see here, which are the ones on the lower color bar. The insignificant differences are heavily faded. For SSP5, we can see quite a bit of additional warming over cities, including in winter. But in summer in particular, the projections for mean temperature are up to 4 to 5 degrees greater in those urbanized areas. And this additional warming on summer is on par with the warming due to the greenhouse gas forced climate change alone. So it's essentially doubling that projected warming. And the projections are similar for minimum and maximum temperature as well. So why the projections that include the land use change differ likely comes down to how energy partitioning and albedo differ over the different land use categories. Here I have summer projection differences in albedo on the left, sensible heat flux in the middle, and latent heat flux on the right. Albedo increases in SSP3 and in SSP5, the yellow coloration in the southeast, where the cropland has replaced the deciduous and needleleaf forest. This reflects more of that incoming solar radiation and damps those temperature increases in the future. Latent heat is also increased, which is a little difficult to see, but there's some latent heat increase here in Missouri and a little bit of decrease here in the south. That latent heat increase and a sensible heat decrease is happening where deciduous forest is reduced, which contributes to the summertime cooling in particular. The latent heat is actually decreased where the needleleaf forest is reduced, though, which counteracts some of the summer albedo cooling effect, which is why that cooling effect isn't consistent through those years, the year in the previous plots that I showed. In SSP5, there's a pronounced urban heat island effect. You see all these scattered points of large change in the heat fluxes and points where albedo has been reduced here. While there are several other factors at play in real heat islands, here that albedo change and the surface evaporative properties are likely explaining some of the differences we're seeing in surface temperature or near surface temperature, as urban land is simply represented as a slab with different properties like albedo, evaporative capacity, and roughness length as well. So the changes to precipitation projections are much more subtle. So I'm only going to focus on summer here because the differences between the no land use change future and the land use change projections are the strongest in summer. At the top here, I have the projected changes in precipitation for summer from the different scenarios of the no land use change, SSP3 and SSP5 on the right. That top color scheme, the purple to the gold, that means that change is not statistically significant. And the bottom color, the green to the red, is statistically significant. The same for the differences in the projections down here at the bottom. I'm now going to zoom in on the SSP5 plot so you can see that a little bit better. Here you can see that there's an enhancement in precipitation over those urbanized points and a decrease around them, and then a broader sort of insignificant decrease across most of the eastern US in particular, where most of this change is happening. Overall, the heat island effect here in SSP5 enhances the convective environment over the urbanized points, leading to more intense precipitation when it does rain and slightly longer events as well. I'm not going to go into detail about the statistics of how the precipitation characteristics like intensity change today, but if you're interested in the details, they are in the recently published paper on this work. But I will show a few fields here that are relevant to the summer precipitation environment though. These are all plots showing the difference between the SSP5 land use change future and the no land use change future simulations for summer. You can see that over the urban areas, and I'm gonna point most at the Chicago area, although it represents what's going on in those other urbanized areas, the warming may be increased by, or possibly aided by, the increased surface roughness as increasing low level convergence into the urban areas, and as a result, upward motion over those urbanized points. There's also decreased surface humidity over those urbanized points, which makes sense as the latent heat flux has decreased. But with all that additional convergence going on, there's still an increase in low-level surface moisture flux. There's also enhanced warming that's destabilizing the lower atmosphere, which is leading to some lower convective inhibition right over those urbanized points. And the LCL and the LFC are higher, but so is the boundary layer height. And this is presumably allowing these levels to still be reached at about the same rate as before, boundary layer height counteracting some of the LCL height changes. And I say it's allowing it to remain about the same because the precipitation frequency doesn't consistently or significantly change across these US eastern area urbanized points much. But again, if you want to see all the statistics about the precipitation, those are in the recently published paper. All of this is generally contributing to the difference in the mean precipitation projections for summer over those urbanized points, with increases over those urbanized points. With the decreases over the surroundings, we're generally seeing less favorable conditions around the cities. Very broadly, there's an increase in low-level divergence, the subsidence, and higher convective inhibition. Over Florida, you can see quite a bit of additional near surface convergence and near surface moisture flux. Florida's mega region, which it turns into in the future, really is contributing to a stronger and much more persistent sea breeze over the full diurnal cycle, really. Which is helping to enhance precipitation even more there. So we can also look at how population exposure to extremes is modulated given our matrix of simulations, and given not just a change in population with the greenhouse gas emissions for climate change futures. But given the interactive effect of population, its effect on the land surface, and the greenhouse gas induced climate change under these different scenarios. So here on the slide, I'm showing the population change for the two different scenarios from 2000 to 2090. Try to ignore some of the weird things going on at the border. That was just simply trying to interpolate here. It's not what Worf saw. And we have a few different exposure options we can look at. Exposure being population times the number of extreme events. We have the scenario where we can look at a population exposure with a constant population in the future under the no land use change simulation, which is really greenhouse gas only. And then we have something that's very commonly done, looking at simulations that don't include the land use change, but do look at the changes in the population under these different scenarios to examine exposure. And then also we have that interactive or total effect of the land use change with the population and the greenhouse gases. So what I have here bar charts that are sort of looking at total extreme heat exposure across all of CONUS. And I have an indicator of maximum temperature here and exposure in terms of the millions of person days where people are exposed to a maximum temperature that's greater than 35 degrees Celsius or 95 Fahrenheit, so hot days. And then on the right, exposure to a minimum temperature that is greater than 20 degrees Celsius or 68 degrees Fahrenheit. Or warm nights, tropical nights, nights where the human body doesn't get to recover as much on those hot nights, contributing to heat stress. And the different colored bars do have a meaning. The greenhouse gas only exposure projection is here in red. We have two different scenarios for SSP3 in green or SSP5 in purple. This SSP3 pop plus the greenhouse gases doesn't include the land use change. And then SSP3 total with the greenhouse gases is including that land use change and its interactive effect with the population. Same for SSP5 and the same for this other chart. At the bottom, we sort of, I have split out some of these effects. So focusing on SSP5 here, because you can see its bars. This is the population only effect here in purple. The land use change effect in the middle bar, and then the combined effect on the right in terms of the millions of person hours of exposure. So what you can see here is that there is a step up essentially between these two purple bars on either side, indicating that the land use change is contributing to that exposure projection, and it is contributing in a pretty significant way, especially in SSP5. Where the land use change is adding about another 33% to the millions of person days of exposure. And then on the right for minimum temperature, about 19% additional exposure here. And note that this has implications for things like energy consumption also, not just human heat stress, for residential and commercial cooling too, not just the human health. Can also split this out by development level to really see where the land use change is making the biggest difference. So I have here the minimum temperature exposure again for minimum temperatures above 20 degrees Celsius. On the left for high intensity development, which is surfaces that are greater than 50% impervious. Low intensity development in the middle, which is 20 to 50% impervious. And then land that is not developed or barely developed, less than 20% imperviousness. So you can really see the influence of the land use change on these projections here with large differences between the bars in both scenario, really. This might not seem like a big difference, but it is actually a pretty significant step up in the increase in projection for SSP3. But of course, it's much greater in SSP5 where we're expanding that urban land. Same is true for the low intensity development surrounding the cities. Over here on the right with undeveloped land under SSP5, you can actually see the counteractive effect of cooling going on in the undeveloped regions due to the land use change. So here I actually have Now, exposure to extreme precipitation in the form of precipitation greater than the 1 hour, 5 year return period, which is a level that matters for urban stormwater management and urban street flooding. It's actually a build spec level that is common in some cities across the US, although the specifications for actually laying stormwater pipes is highly variable. This one is pretty representative. And exposure here now is in terms of the hundreds of thousands of person hours, not millions of days like it was for temperature. And here you can see that in the high intensity development, this SSP3 population adds about 20% more over the greenhouse gas only projection. And then the total projection, which includes land use change, adds another 20% to that. Whereas SSP5 population here more than triples that greenhouse gas only projection. And then the land use change combined with the population adds another 5 times the greenhouse gas only projection to that total value. For low intensity development, we can see that the land use change still matters to the exposure projection. It contributes to a projection increase here that is about the same actually for both SSPs. And you can see that because these green bars here where it splits out the population and land use effect for SSP3 at the bottom is identical, and the same is true with SSP5. And I have made sure that wasn't just a spreadsheet typo. They really are the same. For the non-developed land in SSP5, it's worth noting that the precipitation decrease surrounding the urban area shows up. And decreases that total population exposure to this the extreme precipitation, counteracting about 80% of the increase that's due to just the population in the leftmost purple bar here. So to wrap things up now, and I see I've gone a little fast, but that's okay. Regional climate change projections are sensitive to the SSP-based urban and agricultural land use changes here. That is, they may actually matter, at least at a local to regional scale. And I think the details and the changes here, the magnitudes of them, are potentially less important than the fact that some of these land use changes do significantly affect the climate projections. And perhaps we should be taking them into account in more of our projections in the regional climate modeling community. The urban land expansion is potentially more influential than the cropland expansion. In all of the fields that we've examined, it just generally has a larger effect, at least at a local scale. And this basically says that the SSP scenario matters as well. The population changes and the land use changes also mattered when examining the extreme weather exposure projections. And this mattered for both temperature and precipitation extremes. Exposure is something that's commonly looked at, but there's less to exposure for other extreme events, for like precipitation, than there is for temperature extremes and human heat stress out there in the literature so far. So this work has a bunch of potential discussion points and a lot of caveats. For example, we only used one RCM, forced by one GCM under one RCP with one land surface model and only covered two of the SSPs. So we've definitely undersampled structural uncertainty here. We leveraged those NA Cortex simulations and configuration. And because of that, there was no urban canopy model used here. The urban land was pretty simply represented by differences in the land surface characteristics. And because of that configuration, the fractional land cover change was also not seen, only that dominant type change in a grid box, which probably led to an over or underestimation of some of the land use effects. It also very clearly altered the intended amount of land use change projected by the land use models. And our resolution was only 25 kilometers, which was the standard Cortex resolution for this round of Cortex. And at 25 kilometers, we've probably missed some of those potential urbanization effects, particularly the downstream effect, for example, of the urban canopy on precipitation. Here, that precipitation effect was pretty stovepiped over the grid boxes where the land use changed, although we did have decreases spreading out around those points in precipitation, at least, but no downstream increase effects. The projects could also look at, or similar projects could also look at the methods for applying the land use change in the wharf, along with other wharf configurations, and other SSP-informed land use change model results could be explored, not just the models used here. Particularly, for example, the land use harmonization data set that was used for CMIP, or from other integrated assessment models like the GCAM Demeter data set that's out there as well. And additional work can also consider adding things like urban aerosols if you're running at a finer scale, probably, or anthropogenic heat, transient future land use changes, urban morphological characteristics, and a whole host of other potential items. And I want to add that I'm currently working on new simulations that are meant to address some of these caveats and existing uncertainties that this work didn't get to consider. And that work is still evolving. So I'd be happy to discuss this with you if you're interested outside of the seminar. And with that, I'll wrap up. Thanks.
All right, thanks, Melissa. That was a really interesting seminar. See, we have a few questions already queued up. So if you're in the Zoom room, you can either use the raise hands feature or drop your question into the chat, or just say you have a question, then I'll call on you to unmute your camera and mic. And if you're on the webcast, type your questions into Slido and we'll get to those as well. So I think first we'll start here in the Zoom room. So James Pinto, would you mind unmuting your camera and mic to ask your question?
Sure. Thanks, Melissa. That was a really great, interesting talk. And I have so many questions. I don't know where to start, but the one I posted into the chat was related to the exposure term, and curious if you had looked at also adding in the effects of moisture. You can look at dew point or relative humidity. I guess it depends on what you're interested in. And then even also wind extremes, if that showed up at all, particularly in the sort of the desert Southwest, I was curious if there were more incidences of dry thunderstorms or that kind of thing in the model, related to sort of local urban developments, especially Phoenix, for example.
Mm-hmm. We haven't looked at wind extremes, although that could be incredibly interesting, especially given what you're saying there with Phoenix. We have considered adding dew point to the heat stress calculations, though, mm-hmm. at this point.
Because obviously the dew point's going to be... It's going to make the temperature even feel worse, obviously. So 95 is going to, maybe 90 is going to be enough to really be uncomfortable.
I am working on a set of much higher resolution simulations with a colleague at Cornell University, though, and that is specifically targeted at wind extremes and how the urbanization might affect them and the exposure to the wind extremes, but mostly for the eastern U.S., unfortunately, if you're specifically interested in the Southwest.
Yeah. Well, either way, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, so I don't see any more questions currently in the Zoom room, but if there are more, we can always come back. So for now, let's pop over to the Slido for a couple of questions. So first, we'll start with Roy Rasmussen. His question is, in your simulations, what land use type seems to be most sensitive to climate change?
I'm not sure I'm understanding this question in the correct direction, at least. The land use types aren't directly interacting with the climate change, so they can't be impacted by the climate change in wharf simulations. But the land use type that makes the most, the biggest bang in terms of the climate change projections and adding or subtracting from them is definitely the urban land change. So hopefully that answers that question.
Okay, and then we'll move on to next question by Dave Lawrence. And this is a question that I also had too. So how robust or realistic do you think the precipitation change over urban areas is? Are there indications in present day climate that urban areas receive more precipitation than surrounding areas?
Specifically over the urban areas, I think some of it is realistic, but it's also very stovepiped, and the grid cells at 25 kilometers aren't really having the same urban heat island effect that you would get in reality, where you would actually see enhanced precipitation extending downstream of the urban areas. And there are indications in present day climate in studies that have looked at this, that urban areas can affect the precipitation, and it's generally to increase the precipitation and its intensity sort of over and downstream of the urban areas. And most of the studies that I've seen on this are looking very specifically over cities in China, where we have good observations over the recent period while there has been enhanced urbanization. Higher resolution simulations would probably be much more realistic if you were going to specifically study the urban areas.
Okay. I have another question. Back early in the seminar, you mentioned that when these simulations were run, that WRF could not handle basically splitting the land use type in a grid cell, but that now it can. So, how do you anticipate that new feature in WRF? How do you anticipate that potentially impacting your results?
I suspect. I think it splits over takes into consideration three different fractional land use categories over any given grid cell. And I think the biggest effect would be on the urban land change, because right now it's not seeing a lot of what I would call the urban sprawl away from the centers. And that would definitely have been a greater effect on the near surface temperature when more of that urban land is seen across many more points. For cropland, the effect should still be smaller because there aren't quite as many fractional grid box changes in that land type that aren't being seen, but there should still be some of that spread out as well. And the biggest effect I think will be on the urban land, which was underestimated in SSP5 there by the around 40%, because we couldn't see all that fractional land change. Or WRF couldn't see it all.
Okay. Last call for questions, both in the Zoom room and on the chat.
Actually, I have one more if I can.
Sure, absolutely, we have time. And then we, after you, then we did just get another one on the Slido.
So. Oh, okay. I guess the one thing I was curious about, and you kind of alluded to it, is sort of if you subtracted out the urban heat island impact, how much does sort of the change in land use more generally raise the temperatures over what would happen in just the normal scenario that you're using? So I guess it's sort of...
You can sort of see the same effect over the handful of points sort of in that no land use change simulation that are dominantly urban. When you subtract all these fields, that does disappear though, because over the points that were urban in both scenarios.
Right. And for those different scenarios, do the gaseous emissions change too? So when you're being more urbanized, does CO2 go up more, or is that kind of held constant between the different simulations?
No, in each scenario is following RCP 8.5. So they both have the same emission scenario happening.
Because that could be a different feedback, right? If you're assuming that developing a lot, you're probably emitting more gas too.
Except that the RCP and these urbanized scenarios, or the non-urbanized and the SSPs, they are global scenarios. So it's more of the global effect on CO2 that's being considered. Now there could be other localized effects that we can't capture here in terms of the localized emissions, and probably very particularly with things like aerosol emissions, which could cause some local cooling effects. Especially under the almost business as usual scenario of SSP5, where we're not concerned about limiting emissions.
Right. Okay, thanks.
And then over on the Slido, Meg Fowler asks, it seems like the impacts of extreme heat get more pronounced the longer you remain plane above some threshold. Is the number of consecutive hours above approximately 20 degrees C something you've thought about assessing too, or potentially varying that threshold by region to match up with National Weather Service heat wave definitions?
Thanks for asking that. No, we haven't actually considered that, but that would be very interesting to do. So thanks for bringing that up. Then I see we got another one there.
Yeah, from Fernando de Sales from South Dakota, or SDSU, I don't know whether it's South Dakota State or are SSP3 and SSP5 land use data available at the NCAR data archive?
The land use change data set that I use specifically for this study are available. If you take a look in the paper, it'll point you to a data set DOI, so you could see those data sets specifically. There are others out there, though, if you were interested in similar types of simulations. You're also welcome to email me if you can't find the data archive where these sit.
And maybe just provide your UCAR email.
Bukovsky@ucar.edu.
Good, nice and simple.
Yes.
Okay, well, I don't see any other questions either in the Zoom room or on Slido, so I think we'll wrap things up here. So thanks, Melissa. That was a really fascinating seminar and so many things to investigate with regional climate and to consider with our future projections and just how that impacts all sorts of decisions that we make. So thanks for shedding some light on that. And for everyone else, if you would like to give a RAL seminar in the future, or if you have a colleague who would like to volunteer to give a RAL seminar, just contact me. My email address is jaredlee@ucar.edu. You can Google our RAL, just put into Google RAL seminars, and that link will be the first one that pops up that has a list of upcoming seminars. Our next one is coming up on July 14th from Linda Mearns, also here in RAL. So there are plenty of other dates available, though I understand if summer kind of slows down for seminars. But we're always open for them kind of year round. So shoot me an email for that. And with that, I hope everyone has a great afternoon. And once again, thanks, Melissa, for a great seminar. Bye, everyone.
Thanks for hosting.